It is 4 p.m. in Singapore and 10 a.m. in Milan. Welcome everyone to the Asian Banker Live. Today, we are very happy to be speaking with Mr. Roberto Fulari, General Manager of KBank, one of the first digital banks which was developed from scratch in 2008, before the term digital bank or fintech even came into existence. KBank is a new generation multi-channel and digital bank, part of Mediobanca, Italy's largest investment bank. Prior to its launch, never had a retail banking business. So it is an amazing story. And Mr. Fulari today and I will be talking about the experience of digital banking since its launch in 2008, how it built an open market platform for financial services, how it launched automated advisory services in wealth management, and we're going to be discussing about the future of wealth management and digital banking. Welcome, Mr. Fulari, and we are very glad to be speaking to you. Now, what I want to do in this interview is maybe to address some of the impression or conception about Italian banking. What has been in the news lately is a lot about the crisis and those things. But Mr. Fulari, if you could share about how KBank came into existence.
Yeah, good morning, everyone. KBank, as you said, was born in 2008. So if you go back to that period, there are two things which have to be reminded. The first one is that the internet penetration in Italy at the time, even the internet penetration in banking, was very low at about 10% share. And also we were in the middle of the crisis at that time of the liquidity and the economic crisis in Italy and in Europe at that time. So the idea of Mediobanca, which is the 100% owner of KBanka, was really to find a totally new, brand new model of retailing banking based on a digital platform and on a totally different type of customer experience, even in terms of retailing. So KBanka was really born to find a way to get customers' attention and acquisition in a very different way, in a moment where the shareholder needed the direct access to liquidity, to the market liquidity at that time. So, yes, KBanka was a very challenger bank, is still today a challenger bank. It has been also quoted in a very recent report from Digital Banking Report as one of the most successful challenger banks across the world. We enjoy today about 800 customers and 800,000 customers and about 21 billion in terms of euros, in terms of assets and deposits. So it has been a long journey of 8 years, but very successful. And from the very beginning, the mindset was, how can I really be different and challenging the existing marketplace? To give you an idea, apart from starting really as a digitally native bank at that time in 2008, also the retailing was conceived in a very different way. If you just Google and go, you will see the type of stores which we designed at that time, nothing to do with traditional branches. And also the customer service. All the bankers weren't bankers. At that time, we hired people and salespeople coming from high street retailers, and because the idea was they know how to better serve customers, they are really customer focused rather than traditional bankers coming from traditional banks. And we will train them in order to tell them exactly what to do and the training on banking products, bank accounts, and so on. So it was a very revolutionary idea at that time that I must say it has been very successful. So in a nutshell, I can tell you that the message that I would like to leave is on this part is that yes, you can really. So if you are even an established financial institution as Mediobanca was and is today, at that time you definitely can have a different type of mindset and you can still be very innovative in the marketplace. And yes, you can be successful in the marketplace. And even if the internet penetration is not the one you wanted, even if the marketplace it's undergoing a major development, you can still be very, very successful. So It's possible. Obviously, point is that market condition changes. The uncertainty in these days, in these years, has been much higher than in the past. We are definitely in a market conditions which are not any longer steady as they used to be decades ago. So, to me, it's a bit like the experience that in the Lean Startup book, Eric Ries tries to make and how to make a successful startup. So you need to have a vision. At the same time, also, you have to be flexible in pivoting your strategy and changing it and adapting it when market condition changes. So in this second instance, for instance, we started as a liquidity. The first objective was gain liquidity. So we started with term deposits and savings account, and we built up a lot of deposits gathering at that time. But then when market condition changed a few years ago, we turned the strategy from just deposits gathering to assets transformation, asset gathering, and transformation of deposits in asset management, in investing products, etc. So you need to have also the flexibility to be fast and be flexible in understanding that the market conditions are changing, and you steer the boat where it's most needed.
Now, if I may, Mr. Ferrari, now, in 2008, the first iPhone was probably launched for maybe less than 2 years. What we know now as mobile banking probably hasn't come into existence yet. And you used the term challenger bank, and many of today's challenger banks like Atom or Simple or Fido haven't even started back then. What was the initial business model like? Was it, today when we talk about digital banking, we talk about being mobile first. Obviously, back then it's very different. And who are you benchmarking against in terms of customer centricity, in terms of customer experience, which are such big concept today?
At that time in 2008, you're right. I mean, the iPhone was just launched and there wasn't basically any Facebook in Italy. Was just starting. So I think now the situation has changed a lot, and you need to keep up with the consumer behaviors and with the technology changes and the increasing use of mobile for banking. So our benchmarks at that time were more part of the belonging to the digital banks, which at that time were in Italy. The most important one was definitely at that time ING, which launched ING Direct in Italy a couple of years before. So that was definitely a model that was looked at. And I must say in Europe, ING has been definitely a very good benchmark for all of the digital banks really to see how to perform and build a business. And but the Kebanka and the Mediobanca idea was also to add the branches. At that time, ING didn't have any branches. So we realized that if you want to build up a fast critical mass, you need to have some branches. But as said, there weren't traditional branches. They were more like stores. So you need some physical footprint. This helped us at that time a lot in order to build up the volumes and the customer acquisition. So the benchmark at time is that one. Now that Kebanka is turning into an asset management bank, digitally driven asset management bank, we'd also look at what are the banks which have a good multi-channel strategy in investments and in asset management and in this new type of segmentation that is arising. So there are banks like Fineco or Banca Mediolanum, which we look like because they have a good mix of digital channels and digital customers and digital technology, and at the same time also a good footprint which is definitely needed in this hybrid model, which is really turning up to be this model of wealth management in banking in these days.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Now, tell us a bit about Kbanka today in terms of the Italian banking industry. I mentioned a bit in my introduction that, you know, the sector is under crisis. I think there was a research by a Mediobanca banker in terms of the Texas ratio of some of the banks being above 100%. What kind of a position does K Banker take in the market, and how are consumers looking at you as a bank, where, you know, in banking, trust is very important? I'm sure during this period, how are the banks performing on this core element, whole dimension of trust? And where are you positioning on this dimension of trust, being a digital bank?
Yes, I think we were lucky to belong to Mediobanca. Mediobanca is the most historical and most famous and the biggest, the largest investment bank in Italy. Is extremely solid. So the whole banking group didn't have and doesn't have any problems regarding capitalization or NPLs, which instead are problems of part of the Italian banks. So we started really from very strong roots. Thanks to our shareholder, and this has been definitely a great help in order to build a strategy across the years. So that's the first thing. The second thing, looking at Kebanka has been, just to give you a couple of things, Kebanka has been recognized for the last four consecutive years in a row like the best digital bank in Italy for customer satisfaction. We enjoy the highest NPS value in Italy, very, very high. So Kebanka started really as a customer-focused bank and is enjoying this image and this reputation through really the kind of service that we are delivering to our customers, which are highly satisfied. And this is definitely a key asset of Kebanka. So I think this is the type of positioning and the type of starting image that Kebanka has enjoyed and is still enjoying very much. This so couples with the Mediobanca heritage, so it's an extremely strong combination of trust and solidity from one side, coming from our shareholder heritage, and the modernity, the customer centricity, the type of customer service, the transparency, which is definitely the innovation, which is definitely part of the Kebanka world.
Okay. Are you a separate subsidiary, your own legal entity with your own balance sheet and financial statements?
Yes, we are separate, but obviously our balance sheet it's then aggregated, incorporated into the balance sheet of the whole banking group. But as a legal entity, we're a separate legal entity.
Okay, great. Share with us in terms of your evolution. You mentioned that you started out as a liquidity strategy in terms of term deposits, in terms of capturing the low-cost funding for Mediobanca, and it has evolved since then now into asset management, into wealth management. Talk to us about your business model and where are you making money, how profitable you are, and your cost-to-income ratio, and how big of a credit or a loan business you have, or it is mainly deposits and wealth management.
Okay, we turned profitable last year. So as a traditional book on startups, we became profitable after 7 years. So it takes time really to become profitable. I think for any challenger bank, even if you come from a very strong and established financial institution, because you need to build critical mass from one side, and on the other side, you need to invest in order to gain market share. So, having said that, we enjoy now a good profitability, which is we are in the middle of our fiscal year after just the end of the third quarter, and our profit is above 20 million euros. It's about 23 million euros. So we are now enjoying a more stable and sizable profitability. Our revenues are fastly growing. How do they grow? They grow thanks to the transformation of critical of the deposits into asset management and investing products, so definitely into the commission area, while our interest margin is about stable or so. So we are definitely growing our revenues thanks to the commissions which are coming from the asset management distribution and our funds platform and bank assurance platform which we have. So I think that this is in this sense definitely a very good moment in making the balance sheet stronger also for the future. Yes, we do lending. We do mainly mortgages. This is our core in terms of lending. And we enjoy now a book of about 7 billion euros of mortgages, which come also both from what we did ourselves in terms of really book creation, and also from the recent acquisition of Barclays retailing activity that we did last year in Italy. So the combination of both portfolios gives us now a book of about 7 billion euros in terms of mortgages. So we do lending as well, and very much focused on mortgages.
Okay. Could you share some of the key financials of the bank, for example, your total assets, your asset size, your ROE, NPL, just very briefly?
Well, as I said, we enjoy a total deposits and assets of about 21 billion euros. Of them today, we have about 7 billion, which are really assets under management and administration. The 7 billion, just to give you an idea, was close to zero only 4 years ago. So definitely growing pretty much fast. And 14 is about deposits. Our total revenues are about over 250 million euros, and including everything, so interest margin and commissions. So I think these are the key figures. The profit, I gave you the profit figures. And so as I said, I mean, we are definitely solid today. We really are trying to expand even further into the wealth management and part of the business.
Okay. By those measures, you are still relatively a small bank even in Italy.
We are no longer a small bank. I think we enjoy about a 3% market share. So we are in a middle-sized type of bank. So I think if you combine all the activities, Che Banca will fall into the first 15, 20 banks in Italy. The banking sector in Italy is extremely fragmented with hundreds of banks.
About 500 banks.
Exactly. So we are definitely climbing up our ranking. Also, again, as I said, thanks to the acquisition last year of Barclays retailing activities in Italy, which is the first case, if you want, of a digital bank, board bank, which has bought a more traditional bank branches from traditional banks. The first case probably worldwide, but this gives you an idea how the world is changing.
Yes, that definitely very interesting in terms of how you are disrupting the market. You also mentioned you are advocate of open marketplace platform for financial services. We understand you work with fintechs, not the first bank to adopt open APIs, banking as a platform, and also with PSD2 coming, what are the opportunities do you see?
Yeah, look, I believe really honestly that what was called the universal bank model is really close to the end. I mean, we really lived in centuries maybe or in decades where there was only one monolithic type of business model in banking, which was the universal bank, which does everything for everyone. I think now with the strong digitization of the sector, this is going to an end. I don't mean that universal bank will disappear, but I mean really there will be very different type of business models and much more open than it was before, where everything should have, needed to be built inside a single bank, which had a huge amount of product factories and everything really done from the inside. I think now with open APIs, with the software economy we are heading to, with open APIs and with all the artificial intelligence way which is coming, I think definitely the picture, the scenario is strongly changing. And the entry barriers are falling down, and there are big opportunities for the fintech from one side, but also from those banks like us, which were maybe pre-fintech, as you said at the beginning, which instead are very much open into building something together with the fintech startups or anyway external partners, as the technology is really bringing down all the barriers. So yes, it's true. We've already developed several services which have been commercialized, which have been done and built with fintech startups here in Italy. So, for instance, we've built a couple of years ago, we have launched the first over-the-top mobile wallet, which incorporated, for instance, all the PayPal functions. And you could use it as a wallet also with the credit cards and the payment cards of all other banks in Italy. So it was really an over the top. And we did it and we're still managing it with a fintech startup, an Italian fintech startup here in Italy. We launched last year the first B2C, we were the first bank in Europe to launch the first B2C robo-advisor last year. And that was last year. And again, we did it collaborating with a couple of fintech startups in order to create the whole platform and the whole package. So we do believe, as you said, we believe in APIs. We have about 1,500 APIs right now. I think that's the future. So you can choose what you want to have inside and what you want to keep developing from your own product factories, and you can open up the rest to external partners and vendors even. So there is a big opportunity if you want to do a lot of R&D outside of your own resources and your own legacies. That's the big problem of traditional banks, which instead, you know, are completely maybe trapped by their own legacies, which are first cultural, but also, you know, technological, where still everything is dominated by mainframes, which are really very old, of maybe 2 or 3 decades or 4 decades old. So on the other side, the fintech startups, they really have a blank sheet, so they can really provide you with solutions and opportunities which it would take years probably to you to do the same.
Okay. How many people do you have? Tell us a bit about how important is your physical distribution. Now, we talk about all this API and fintech and necessarily banks becoming virtual businesses, and the introduction of robo-advisory, robo-process automation, and so on and so forth. Obviously, room for much more efficiency increases, and also room for much more opportunity to lower human resource costs, in a sense, so to speak.
Let's say that if I look at how we are developing and the resources and what then it's happening into the robo space. In terms of resources and multi-channel, let's say, strategy that we have, CheBanca now enjoys the combination of the two networks, the one really from CheBanca and the second one which are the branches which we bought from Barclays. So the combination of both is about 130 branches, a bit more. We are going to rationalize them because there are some overlaps given the acquisition. So I think we will end up with less branches, a little bit maybe more than 100, and this is probably the size that we would like to keep for the future in Italy. As I said, we don't consider them branches. At the very beginning, we considered them like stores. Now we are really considering them like advisory centers. Okay. So, and this goes into the robo and into the wealth management camp. So for us, the future of branches, it's made of giving advice into what are the added value products and services you can serve your customers, like asset management, or even mortgages. I think this is really where really there will be still, at least for the next 10 years, the need of having branches. And so advisory centers. Second point is definitely branding, because I mean it's branding. If you think of Apple Store, so stores are part of your brand and they can help you out in order to improve your branding and your reputation. And we, for instance, know that our market share is far higher where we do have, in the towns where we do have our branches, rather than in towns where we don't have any branch at all. So this gives you an idea that in terms of reputation and in terms of, you know, consumers feeling anyway safe, having some physical presence, at least in Italy, I don't think it's just in Italy, is still very much important. And third point is that obviously it's a customer service point. If there is something really serious in terms of customer problems, it's still definitely a good point of customer service and explaining our services, maybe the one which are more complex, as I said before. So we enjoy also our virtual branch, which is our remote channel. Our remote channel for us, it's not just a customer, a call center or a customer service. It's definitely the number one branch, a virtual branch in Kebanka. Sells a lot, so it doesn't do just customer service. It's a sales and a relationship channel. And it's also very productive for selling investment products and funds. So I think apart from the branches, we do have a customer service. We do have the digital channel. Just to give you an idea, we make 40% of our cross-selling to our existing customer base via the digital channels. So the digital channel, our digital sales account for about 40% of our total sales. It's really a very good mix of physical footprint, very innovative, very customer-centric from one side, with the digital channels and remote channel as well. All we try to do is to try to integrate the channels as much as we can, because this is key for the customer experience, for the transparency. And if I can, I can tell you, I really see the concept of, it's not really multi-channel or omni-channel. For me, the concept is really of unified channels. So the customer really, we need to manage the channels as they were basically one, and just with the delivered in a different way. And in this, obviously, having APIs is key, because this makes the customer experience definitely, and also the experience of our bankers, the way we serve our customers, definitely much more streamlined and simple than in traditional banking.
Okay. A couple more questions, and this relate to, again, the channel strategy and the retention of physical channel. Today, is it driven by customer preference, the need to talk to a person in the branch to verify transactions, for example, through a physical person, or is it regulatory in terms of the ability to, say, do eKYC to be able to onboard customers through digital channels only? What is now today the key driver for your distribution strategy? Customer? Regulation?
No, I think it's customer. We really have a strategy, as I said, of unified channels, which means customer is free to choose which channels to use as much as we are able to, but it's definitely like that. Just to give you an example, two examples, very simple. One, the customer, each single customer can go to any branches. There isn't any physical allocation or even, you know, technical allocation of customers to branches. If there is a full, customers enjoy a full circularity across the branch network. So they can go anywhere, they can do anything in any type of branch, and as I said, also through the remote channel. Second thing is that our yellow advice, which is the robo advisor, again, this is also completely transparent to customers. So customers can choose. Either they do it everything by themselves, so we call it as a self mode online, 100% online by themselves, or they decide to do it online but with the assistance of remote advisor, or they can decide to use the service through our bankers and advisors into the branches. So this is really up to the customer, and the customer decides really what to do. This is one of the key principles for us.
Okay. My final question is, as a challenger bank, achieving scale is very important. You've been in business for the last 8 to 9 years. You've grown your business to about 800,000 customers, and you mentioned about close to 200 million euro in AUM from a small-sized bank to a mid-sized bank. But still, the growth isn't as quickly, and some of that growth has been through acquisition as well. What's your strategy in terms of gaining even greater scale going forward?
Yeah, I mean, I think the first thing is if you need scale, and in banking you do need scale, you need a consistency in terms of investment and what you do. And you need to look at really how you build your revenues, because one of the key questions of all the new neobanks coming, which are mobile only, is always how do you really build revenues? Because you don't get revenues from transactions in banking anymore. I mean, from at least from customers' transactions. So you need to find other ways to get revenues. Having said that, our way of forward is to continue to build from one side our products, especially in the wealth management arena, so to continue to build our revenues in this area of banking, and to continue also to strengthen our physical presence, not only via the branches, as I said. I mean, we reached what we believe is our cap on branches, but also to use financial advisors which can visit the customers at home or in their offices. So building a network of financial advisors which can use our products and platforms and our brand and our platforms, really, which are really state of the art also in terms of managing additional channels. And this is the strategy where we are heading to. So very much into the wealth management, focusing and continue to grow into the wealth management from one side. On the other side, more products, more initiatives in this arena, an additional expansion of a network of financial advisors.
Okay, great. Thank you so much, Mr. Falari, for sharing this insight with us about the growth of K-Banks over the last 8 years, and definitely a important case studies for banks that are moving towards digitization, moving towards an open bank platform. One of the institutions that they must be looking at and studying. Thank you so much.